Welcome back, guys, to another video. Although, should I really be saying another video? Because I haven't posted in like 3 weeks, a month. It's been the draft. And before that, it was like a month before that. So listen, all right? I'm sorry. I didn't mean for it to be like this, but we'll just say I've been busy. Sure, we'll go with that. I've been so busy, out of my mind, that I have not been able to post. And also, I'd just like to say that sound in the background, I'm sorry, my furnace or whatever in the house just turned on right as I decided I want to record. So thank you for that, house. I appreciate it. But without further ado, I'm not going to waste any more of your time. You clicked on this video to see a grading of the team's offseason, and that's exactly what I've done. I've gone through every single team, every single move that they've made this offseason, or at least move of significance, and I base it off that and what they're trying to do. Are they trying to get better? Are they trying to get worse? And how well they've done of a job of doing that specific goal that they're trying to do. But I'm going to go in alphabetical order. We're going to start off with the Anaheim Ducks. And the Anaheim Ducks, I give them a grade of a B-. And Anaheim this season, they got Frank Vatrano on a pretty solid contract, I think. Ryan Strome is a risky one. That one, I don't know if it'll age well because obviously he's, I think, 29 now, and it's a five-year deal, and his points might have been inflated by playing with Artemi Panarin. So that might not go very well. We'll see. Isaac Lundestrom got a pretty good contract. And they signed John Klingberg pretty recently at a one-year, $7 million deal, which I think is pretty good for them and definitely helps the loss of Josh Manson and Hampus Lindholm last season. That definitely helps relieve that loss a little bit because obviously those two left, they were left with a pretty weak back end. Adding John Klingberg, that helps a bit. And you have to hope Jamie Drysdale takes a step up. And then I think they have like some Olin Zellwiger or something is one of their prospects who's pretty good. If he can step in and play good, this could be a solid defense. And honestly, I gave Anaheim a B-. You know, I thought they did solid. I thought they did a decent job of making themselves better. Definitely not as good of a job as like an Ottawa did or Detroit, but they took a few steps forward this season. And in a weak Pacific division, we'll see if they can manage to squeak their way into a playoff spot. But now moving on to the Arizona Coyotes. And the Arizona Coyotes, I gave them a C+, because they didn't do much. They kind of did okay. They're just continuing on their trend of, we're going to get for Bedard. We're going to go for Bedard. Like this year, they were going for Wright, supposedly, until they decided to skip on Wright at 3, which honestly, I don't think is the worst move in the world. I actually kind of agree with that, but that's for another video. They kind of continue going down towards the bottom of the league this year. They do pick up Zach Cassian, though, in a cap dump by the Oilers, which I think was a pretty good move for Arizona. They got a pretty good amount out of that. Patrick Nemeth, another cap dump by the Rangers, got a pretty good haul from that. And they signed a couple guys, nothing crazy. Troy Stetcher came on the team, but yeah, C+, like it was okay offseason, nothing much. They're gonna suck next year, which is probably what they want to do, because obviously they're going for Bedard right now. But it sucks if he goes there. It's like, who's gonna be rooting for him? What, they got fans? No, they don't have fans. No one's gonna be getting a Bedard jersey because there won't be anybody with an Arizona Coyotes jersey. I don't have one. I don't have an Arizona Coyotes jersey, and I don't plan on getting one soon. But now on to the Boston Bruins. I'm sorry, all Arizona fans watching this video. I'm just joking. I'm pretending as if there's any Arizona fans watching this video. The Boston Bruins, I have given them just a straight C because this season, this offseason, it's been nothing. Like, what have they done? There's been nothing big from Boston other than a Eric Halla, Pavel Zacha trade in which they acquired Pavel Zacha. I did like that trade for Boston. They have not signed Pavel Zacha yet. I think it might go to arbitration here pretty soon. So depending on what he gets, that could make this trade better or worse. And they haven't gotten a high grade or anything because Marchand's not re-signed. Or no, Marchand is re-signed. He wasn't even need to be re-signed. I meant Bergeron. Bergeron isn't re-signed. And then David Krejci, is he still as good as he was before? Because there's rumors that they want to bring him back, right? And then have Bergeron and Krejci again as their top two centers, supposedly. But I don't know that Krejci would be that same guy that he was before. Obviously, he's getting older. And Bergeron, he has to fall off at some point. But will they even re-sign him? We'll see, because they have not done that yet. But yeah, it's just been a pretty dead offseason for Boston so far. But now on to one of my favorite teams, and that is the Buffalo Sabres. And the Buffalo Sabres, I've just given them a C+. There were no trades for Buffalo this offseason, but they did make a few signings. Oh, the furnace turned off. Thank God. Craig Anderson got a $1.5 million contract. That's some good goalie depth there. Jacob Bryson, they signed. Vinny Hinostroza, who I liked last season, got a one-year deal. Victor Olofsson's on a solid deal now. They got Ilya Labushkin for a pretty good price. And Eric Comrie, who I'm interested to see, because he had a great season in Winnipeg last year. So it'll be interesting to see if he can bring that season into Buffalo and maybe take that starting position, which could kick Craig Anderson out, which is kind of funny considering the amount of money they gave him. At $1.5 million, you'd expect him to be in their lineup, but it's possible that Eric Comrie and Ukko-Pekka Lekkonen could be the tandem for Buffalo next season, because I do like Eric Comrie, and I feel like Ukko-Pekka Lekkonen has shown that he is ready to play at the NHL level. But now moving on to one of the teams that had the busiest offseason this year, and that is the Calgary Flames. And the Calgary Flames had really not a lot of moves, a lot of re-signings, but one absolutely massive move. They traded, everybody knows this by now, they traded away Matthew Tkachuk and a 2025 fourth round pick, conditional, I don't exactly know what the conditions are, for Jonathan Huberdeau, Cole Schwind, a 2025 first round pick, and I believe it's lottery protected or top 10 protected. And that's enough, right? If you saw that trade, you'd be like, all right, Calgary did a pretty good job considering Matthew Tkachuk, he wants out. He's not going to re-sign long-term, so they're under pressure to trade this guy. So they're probably not going to get a lot back. But this trade already looks great. And then you see Mackenzie Weegar is in there as well. Calgary got a huge haul for Tkachuk, and I do think that they did a very good job in this trade. And there are rumors that Huberdeau and Weegar are talking extension with them. So if they can get these guys two extensions, then that is a easy win for me for Calgary in this trade. But then they signed Kevin Rooney, kind of fourth line guy, to a 2-year deal. Nikita Zadorov, considering the price of defensemen, got a pretty good deal as well. Shillington, 2 years, $2.5 million. That is a fantastic deal, I believe. And then Mangiapane, 3 years, $5.8 million. We'll see how that ages. He had a very good first half, not as great second half. So did I even say their grade? Oh, I didn't. It'll be there the whole time. I'm sorry, I did not say their grade. It was an A minus. It's been there the whole time. That's my bad. Yeah, they get an A minus.
Editing Joni here. Huberdeau just signed for like 8 years, $10.5 million. Pretty good deal, I think. Pretty good deal. But yeah, we'll see how it ages. So back to the video.
But now moving on to Carolina. And Carolina, this offseason, kind of wasn't, I'm just going to say the grade. I feel like I should say the grade and then talk. Okay, so Carolina gets a B. They had a solid offseason. They missed out on free agency, didn't sign a lot of free agents, but they made up for that with their trades. In fact, they haven't signed. They've only signed one free agent that was another team, and that was Andrei Kasha, and I do like that signing. But the trades, let's get to the trades, the bread and butter of their offseason. They trade away Tony DeAngelo. They had to do that, I think. Well, they didn't have to, but they didn't want to re-sign him for the price that he wanted. So they trade him away, get a decent haul considering he was an RFA. But then the big trades. They get Brent Burns from San Jose for Steven Lorenz, Itu Makaniemi. I might mess these names up. And a 2023 third. And really, these guys aren't like studs or anything. Not guys that we'll see become great players in the NHL. Most likely, obviously, there's that possibility. But I think they did a great job in kind of replacing Tony DeAngelo here, because Brent Burns, although he's getting older, is still a very solid defenseman, and I think he should be for the last 3 years of this contract, or at least the last one or two. And it's also 33% retained by San Jose, so I do like this trade. And then they get Max Pacioretty for free. Yep, for free. And we'll get to Vegas later because, man, I don't know what that, does their GM know hockey? Does he watch hockey, or does he just like, he's like me on EA Sports is what Vegas is like. But Carolina does a great job in managing to get Max Pacioretty for free. That's great. So that kind of helps the loss of Vincent Trocheck as well. And they also lost Nino Niederreiter. So again, Carolina kind of taking all these guys they've lost, and they've managed to find creative ways to bring new guys in who I believe will produce at a great rate for them as well. But now moving on to the Chicago Blackhawks. This team has been a train wreck for a while, and this offseason I gave them a C-. And some of you may think they deserve a lower grade, and I can definitely see that, but I just didn't think it was a horrible offseason. I didn't think it was good. Now here's the worst move, all right? I'll start off with their worst move, and that was definitely the DeBrincat trade. So they traded Alex DeBrincat for Ottawa. Ottawa's first round pick, which ended up being Kevin Krasinski, so they better hope that this guy ends up being a stud defenseman. Kale McCarr level, I'm talking. And he is a good offensive defenseman, but it's a risky play. We'll see. He was projected around like the teens when they picked him a little early. So we'll see how that works out for them. They also got a second and a third in 2022, the second was, and in 2024, the third was. But they should have got more for DeBrincat. They really should have. You could definitely tell that they were in a rush to get a deal done because they wanted to be in this draft. So they kind of rushed. That same with Kirby Dach. Kirby Dach, they traded away, and they got a Montreal's first, actually the Islanders first, that went to Montreal, that went to them. It's confusing, three-team trade. So they got that first, and they got a 2022 third. But the difference is, I do like the pick that they made with that first. They picked Frank Nazar, who was one of my personal favorites. If you look back to the mock drafts that I did earlier in the season, at one point I actually had Frank Nazar at third, I think, which was really high, but I just really liked his game. And I do think he will be a great top six forward one day. So honestly, this actually might have been a pretty good move for Chicago. And they picked up Peter Mrazek to move up in the draft a little bit. Chicago obviously trying to be a bad team right now. Peter Mrazek, they kind of need an NHL level goalie. Contract's expensive. I don't think that bothers them too much. It's not like they're trying to win or anything. So this trade, whatever. I guess they moved up. I don't know. Not amazing trade, I guess. But they did sign a couple NHL level players because you want to have an NHL level lineup, at least to an extent, I think. They got Max Domi, 1 year, $3 million. Andrei Athanasiou to the exact same deal. I do like both those contracts. And they signed Colin Blackwell to a couple year deal. Yeah, overall, again, okay offseason. The only thing that would really drag it down for me is that DeBrincat trade, which was just not good. They should have got a lot more for DeBrincat. Again, if you have them in the D's or you think they did a worse offseason, I couldn't argue with you too much. Now onto the Colorado Avalanche, and Colorado Avalanche is another team that's just kind of had an okay offseason, a C+. They got Georgiev for a pretty good amount, like they didn't trade too much, a 2022 third, a 2022 fifth, and a 2025 third. Yep, okay. So not even a second round pick being given up for that goalie, and they signed him to a deal as well. 3 years, $3.4 million, which honestly, as much as that might look a little high because the last couple years for him haven't been that great, anytime a goalie goes to Colorado, their numbers are always good. And I think it's just because Colorado is that good of a team. But Georgiev, I think this deal will work out. I think he's a good goalie and I believe in him. They mostly just re-sign guys though. Like this offseason, I didn't give him a huge grade because they're mostly just re-signing guys they had before. Like Cogliano gets a one-year deal. Manson comes back. Helm. Lekkonen comes back on a pretty well-paying contract. Hopefully he can perform up to that. And then Nichushkin, same thing, comes back on a 8-year, $6 million deal. So overall, just a messy offseason. They bring everybody back. Stanley Cup champs. What else would you do? I mean, they kept everybody. So that's really what you want after you win a cup. Except for Kadri, but we'll see. Rumors are he's going to the Islanders. But now moving on to the Columbus Blue Jackets. And the Columbus Blue Jackets, despite making some questionable signings, maybe a questionable trade, I've still managed to give them an A- because they got Johnny Gaudreau. They got him. How did they get him? I don't know. And it completely took away the star players that want to play in Columbus. That whole narrative is gone completely because Patrick Laine also stayed on a 4-year deal. And I think Johnny Gaudreau definitely played a big part in that because now he's like, oh, I got to play next to the second point scorer last year. This is definitely going to up my points, up my play. So Patrick Laine, Gaudreau, two big stars. They traded away Bjorkstrand for nothing, basically, but it was for cap space because they want to get Gaudreau, want to keep Line A on that deal, which also kind of looks a little pricey, but I think it'll work out playing next to Gaudreau. Eric Goodbranson signed to a pretty expensive deal, but again, despite all this stuff, it's like overall, they got Gaudreau, and I think they're going to be a far better team than they were last year, maybe. Like, competitive, because there wasn't really any competitiveness in the East this season, or last season. This season, but there will be next season. I'm thinking East will actually be more competitive than the West with all these teams rising up from the East. But now moving on to the Dallas Stars, and the Dallas Stars, I just gave them a C+. They didn't make any trades this offseason. They signed Denis Gurianov to a 1-year, $2.9 million deal. Scott Wedgwood's coming back as the backup. Their one big move that they did make, however, was they signed Mason Marchment to a 4-year, $4.5 million deal. That could be a bit of a risk just because obviously he was just a depth forward, and then last year he blows up, plays amazing, looks great the whole season in the 54 games he played. So hopefully that 54 games is how he's going to play the next 4 years, because if it's not, then this cap hit's going to be a bit high. But overall, okay season, offseason for Dallas. And now moving on to the Detroit Red Wings. And this might be one that you guys disagree with me on, because I gave Detroit a B+. You guys might think that they deserve an A, but let me just say why I didn't give him an A, all right? So Ville Husso, they traded for him, only gave up a third. Pretty good trade. They signed him. 3 years, $4.75 million. Goalies are a bit risky in that way. $4.75 million might be a bit more than I would have wanted to give Ville Husso, considering he had a really good season. One good season. Last season wasn't great. The season before this season was not a great season for him. And in the playoffs, he also did not look great. So that would kind of scare me a bit. So this deal being 3 years, $4.75 million, might scare me just a little bit, but goalies are kind of like that. Then we get to another questionable move that kind of helps me like not give him an A. They bring in Ben Chiarot, 4 years at $4.75 million. That I think is too much. Like with the Husso, I say, okay, maybe it works out. With the Ben Chiarot though, I just don't think it does. I think Ben Chiarot was definitely overpaid in this situation. However, again, I'm saying all these couple moves that made me bring him down a bit, but why don't we give him some praise? Why'd they get a B plus? They brought in Andrew Kopp on a pretty good contract. They brought in Dominic Kubalik. They brought in David Perron, good pickup by them, and they got Olli Maatta, who is a solid defenseman from the LA Kings, I believe, who played last season. So this was a overall pretty solid offseason for me for Detroit, and I think this definitely helps propel them towards a playoff spot. But now moving on to the Edmonton Oilers, my favorite team. I try to be as least biased as I can, and I think honestly I go harder on my own team than I would on another team, but I gave them a B because I think it was solid. I don't think they had an amazing offseason. I just think they had a solid offseason. Start off, the Cassian, they definitely overpaid to get rid of Cassian. That's the one thing. They trade Cassian out and they give up another second. Like, how many seconds are we going to see the Oilers give up? Because it feels like they never have a second round pick. They traded two for Athanasiou a few years ago. I think they gave up one for Brett Kulak. And now we're giving up another one to drop Zach Cassian. I don't think they needed to pay that much to get rid of Zach Cassian. It's not like he's a trash player, just a little bit overpaid. But then we go on to the signings. And this is where I think that they did a pretty good job overall. Evander Kane, 4 years, $5 million. Very good deal. It worked in Edmonton. It just did with McDavid. So happy to see him back as an Oiler fan. Jack Campbell, 5 years at $5 million. They needed a starter. And Campbell and Skinner, soup and stew, as people have been calling it in Edmonton. I do like that tandem. Although Campbell's 30 and it's a five-year deal, might not age great. I am still happy that we do have starter goalie. And I think that he will be fine in Edmonton. And I'm excited to see him play. And then we go on to Brett Kulak, also a pretty good signing. I liked him. He played great when he came to Edmonton, looked really good in the playoffs. So again, happy to see him back. Puljujärvi and Jamo both signed $3 million deals. Jamo just recently for 2 years, Puljujärvi for 1 year. And then the one thing that got me questioning a bit, Matthias Janmark. 1 year, $1.25 million. Not that that's a bad cost, but they just don't need him. And that cap space could affect their ability to re-sign McLeod. So again, Janmark coming in on a solid cap hit. I'm excited to see him play, but he's probably going to be a fourth line guy if he even plays, because the one thing the Oilers do have is a pretty good offensive group, and I just don't know if Janmark fits into that this season, but a solid offseason for the Oilers nonetheless. Moving on to another one of my favorite teams. Okay, so I have three. It's Edmonton, Buffalo, Florida. So here we go. Florida, the third team, and Florida, as I talked earlier, paid a ton to get Matthew Tkachuk, but here's the thing. I can kind of see where they're coming from. I just feel like they could have given up a little less. Like Huberto for Tkachuk, again, one for one. You could hear that trade and be like, oh, okay. But then they also give up Uyghur. They give up Cole Schmidt, who is a prospect who probably doesn't amount to too much. You never know, though. And then a 2025 first, again, lottery or top 10 protected. Probably should have checked before I record this. But they needed to clear cap space to re-sign Tkachuk, and that's why there's this much in this deal. Could they have found another way to do it? Probably. Because I doubt any other team had a offer even close to this. Like St. Louis's offer rumors were not even close to this. I think it was like Kyrou was the rumor, like Huberto, Jonathan Huberto and Mackenzie Uyghur. So, but whatever, they overpay, they get Tkachuk. Maybe that helps him in the playoffs next year season. He's a tough guy, tough player, hard to play against. As if I'm in the NHL. They re-signed a ton of guys. Etu Lusterainen, obviously Tkachuk on that deal. Rudolph Balcers, I thought was a good signing. And yeah, so overall, just an okay. I gave him a C. I didn't say that again, but it was on there. I should probably remember to do that at the start more often. But now moving on to the LA Kings. And LA, I gave them a B plus because one big move they made right at the start of the offseason, and that was acquiring Kevin Fiala. They took advantage. They said, okay, Minnesota, they need to get rid of this guy because they don't have cap space. So they did it. They gave him Brock Faber, who probably, again, won't be a stud NHL player, like a B prospect. And then a 2022 first in Liam Ofgren. That's who Minnesota ended up drafting. And honestly, LA, I think they did a good job of taking advantage of the situation, as well as re-signing Kevin Fiala to a deal that might end up not aging great. He's only 26, I think, or 27. So he's still young. So the 7 year, $7.8 million deal might actually work for the whole thing, but it is a high price, and you better hope that Fiala manages to keep the offensive numbers that he had in Minnesota. And be able to bring them to LA, because I just don't know. LA feels like a bit more of a defensive team, but again, we'll see. I'm sure if he's on that power play, things could definitely work out for him. He also got Kempe re-signing, Brendan Lemieux, Gabriel Vilardi, just overall a B+, solid offseason. And then we move on to the Minnesota Wild, funnily enough. So the Minnesota Wild, just talked about it, that trade got kind of taken advantage of, and I did give him a C-. Now, I didn't give him a lower grade because I feel like, considering everything that they're dealing with, the buyouts that limits their cap a ton, like 12 million or something, they are dealing with it right now, the cap space. And considering that, they didn't do bad, I don't think. Like, you get Kevin Fiala out, you get an okay haul. Liam Ulfgren, I'm a fan of him, but I feel like they should have got more, but again, kind of under pressure. And then they get they trade away Cam Talbot for cap space as well, because they have some cap problems, but they get back Philip Gustafson. And if Philip Gustafson works out, this could be a great trade. He's shown that he can be good at the NHL level. Obviously, last season was not very good for him, but the season before, he showed in a small sample that he could be very good. So we'll see if he can bring that to Minnesota. And they re-signed Jacob Middleton, a solid defenseman, and Marc-Andre Fleury. So again, they're really fighting the cap. A decent offseason considering everything going on. And it's impressive that they're managing to put together a competitive lineup despite having, like, what is it, 70 million in cap compared to like 80. Like, they're low on cap space, just low in cap period. Now moving on to the Montreal Canadiens. And the Montreal Canadiens, I think, had one of the best off seasons this year, and that is a lot due to the draft, some of the trades they made at the draft. But we'll start off with them getting Evgeny Dadonov for free, another player Vegas gave up for free. This is becoming a thing now. Marc-Andre Fleury, Evgeny Dadonov, Max Pacioretty. There's probably another one in there that I'm missing, and I'll figure it out when I go to Vegas. But good move by Montreal. 1 year left on his contract. And he did pretty good, too. He did pretty good in the second half. Then we had the draft trade. They managed to work from Romanov and a fourth to Kirby Dach, which I think is pretty good. Like I said, I like the player that Chicago drafted in Frank Nizar, but who knows if Montreal would have drafted him. And going from Romanov to a fourth to Kirby Dach, I think that's a pretty good work up the ladder for Montreal. And I think, I forget their GM's name. I think it's Hughes or something. Anyway, whatever his name is, I think he's done a very good job of building this Montreal team to this point. Even to the extent where I look at their lineup and say maybe, like, not the playoffs, but like, they should be a good amount better, especially with Slafkovský being added to that lineup. So I am pretty impressed with what Montreal's managed to do this offseason. But now, moving on to the Nashville Predators. So we're halfway through and I'm 20 minutes in. This is looking like it could be a 40-minute video. Nashville got Ryan McDonagh for not a lot, and they got a B-. I gave Nashville a B-, a pretty solid offseason. They got Ryan McDonagh. Okay, anyway, the camera fell down. I'm back. They got Ryan McDonagh for not a lot. Obviously, he's getting older, has that decently expensive contract, and I do think Ryan McDonagh is a good defenseman and will definitely add to that Nashville Predators defense. And then they traded away Luke Kunin, got John Leonard in a third. I don't know, it's a pretty minor trade. Luke Kunin, though, he's been a good depth forward for them for a bit, and I don't see John Leonard being that guy for them, but whatever. They signed Jeremy Lauzon to a deal that I think is too expensive, which is kind of weird. When I came out, I saw this deal and I was like, you're signing this guy who just hasn't proved himself very much, and when he came to your team, he wasn't good. Like, he wasn't that good in Nashville, honestly. 13 games, I think he had like one assist, and he just didn't look that great defensively either. So 4 years, $2 million, definitely got my eyebrows raised a little bit. But they do manage to get Forsberg re-signed. They pick up Niederreiter and Zach Stanford from, I believe it was Winnipeg, he played on this year. And I think those moves are good. And Nashville definitely trying to stay as competitive as they can for as long as they can, because that feels like the position that Nashville's in right now. But now moving on to the New Jersey Devils. And the New Jersey Devils, I just gave them a straight C. I honestly thought their offseason was just okay. I did like them picking up Vitek Vanacek. Again, the contract that they signed him to might be risky, but with goalies, it's like that. But hey, 3 years, $3.4 million, he could definitely live up to that. I'm kind of scared, though, because every goalie that plays in New Jersey seems to disappoint, at least lately. So we'll see how that works out. Trading away Pavel Zacha for Erik Haula, I feel like you could have done better with trading away Pavel Zacha, I'm not going to lie. I did like them picking up John Marino. It's a risky play trading away Ty Smith. He's only 22. He played great last season. Yes, this season was not very good, but you know, they do get John Marino, who is a very solid defenseman for Pittsburgh and should carry that over to New Jersey. And then some of the signings, like I said, Vitek Vanacek, the price might work out, it might not. Some of these guys they signed him to, definitely look like it could be a bit of an overpayment. Like, I look at Andre Palat. Andre Palat got 5 years at $6 million, and he's 31. And his season last year wasn't even his greatest season. He had a bit of a down year, I guess, by his standards. Well, not a down year. It was okay. It was like 50 points in 75 games. But like, and that's on a Tampa Bay Lightning team that is very good. So I just don't know how this contract is going to work out. It kind of reminds me like the Calgary Flames signing Blake Coleman. And that hasn't looked like the greatest deal so far yet either. They got Siegenthaler back. Jesper Bratt, they weren't willing to pay $6.5 million or whatever it was. But whatever, they managed to work that out, I guess, because Jesper Bratt is on a one-year $5.45 million deal, which I think is a very good cap hit for him. I'm just surprised they weren't willing to pay like the $6 million or whatever he was asking for, because that is not that much for Jesper Bratt. Moving on to the New York Rangers. And the New York Rangers, I gave them a C. Again, an okay offseason. They lost a couple guys. They lost Kopp. But they lost Kopp, and they kind of replaced him with Vincent Trocheck. I don't know. I'm trying to think. See, I'm 24 minutes in. I'm kind of losing my head a little bit here. I'm going to try to speed it up just a little bit. Gorgiev, they got rid of Gorgiev. They didn't get Gorgiev. And they got probably not as good of a haul as you'd want. I feel like you'd want at least a second. But again, he was coming off a couple down years. They trade away Patrick Nemeth in a cap dump in order to re-sign some guys. And I believe that's where Vincent Trocheck comes in. They get him. I like that deal. It might not age well, but for the first 3-4 years, that should still look very good. They bring Yaroslav Halakhin as a backup. Definitely a risky play, but behind Igor Shesterkin, it should be fine because he's not going to get as in many games. New York's a better team than Vancouver, so I would expect his numbers to be a little bit better this season. And then Kaapo Kakko, 2 years, $2.1 million. This deal could potentially end up looking like a steal as soon as this season if Kakko finds his game, because for years we've been waiting for Kakko to look like that second overall pick, and it just hasn't happened. So we'll see if this season that can happen. But now moving on to the Ottawa Senators. And the Ottawa Senators are the only team out of all the teams that I've given an A+. They picked up... All right, we're going to start off this. So every move that they made, I think, was good. Every single one. Every single move they made was either okay or great. There was no bad moves this offseason, which is funny because Ottawa's GM, as early as this trade deadline, was seen as... he's made some questionable moves. I don't think he's great, but this offseason has changed everything. He's went from like an okay GM to everybody views him as a pretty good GM right now. Because we start off, he gets Alex DeBrincat for nothing, for pennies. Now, it was a first round pick, but it's Alex DeBrincat. This guy has two 40 goal seasons, including, I believe, this year he got 40 goals. So he is a very good player, going to add a lot to that Ottawa Senators lineup and possibly make them a playoff contender, not a contender for the cup, but a playoff team. He definitely adds a lot to that forward group, which is now looking deadly, because not only that, they added a Claude Giroux. Yep, they signed Claude Giroux to a pretty good deal, 3 years at $6 million. Not bad. My man does not age a lot, so I expect him to be pretty good for most of that deal. And oh, they got a bit of a goaltending problem. We'll get Cam Talbot. Yep, that's a good idea. Cam Talbot, very solid goalie. Not gonna blow the roof off the place. Not gonna put up a 920, but he should be a solid goalie. And him and Forsberg together as a tandem, that should work decently well and possibly well enough to get them to a playoffs, I think, as well. Which brings me to Matt Murray. They managed to get rid of Matt Murray without paying too much. I think it's like 25% retained. Not bad. And then they get rid of Connor Brown because you bring all these great forwards in and you have to get rid of somebody. You can't just keep them because you don't want to pay a third liner at that point, because at this point they have so much offensive depth with Norris and everybody, all these young guys coming up, that Connor Brown's kind of getting pushed down to the third line, and you just don't want to be paying that much for a third liner. So getting a second for him, I don't think was that bad. And then again, they re-signed Josh Norris, who has been great for them, and they re-signed Matthew Joseph at 4 years, $2.95 million. And what's interesting with me is that Matthew Joseph, when he came to Ottawa in 11 games, he had 12 points, which is crazy because he did not do anything near that in Tampa. So the fact that he managed to do that in Ottawa was crazy. And I do like the steal, and I just really like what Ottawa's done. And they also have Jake Sanderson coming up next year. Just things are looking up for Ottawa. And honestly, they might be a hot take for me to have going into the playoffs next season. But now moving on to the Philadelphia Flyers. In Philadelphia, I gave them a C+. They had an okay offseason. The problem with Philadelphia is I just don't know what they're trying to do. They're clearly a team that's likely not good enough to make the playoffs that thinks they're good enough to make the playoffs, which kind of reminds me of San Jose. It's just like San Jose. The one thing they do though that I like is they bring in Tony DeAngelo, sign him to a 2-year, $5 million deal. I also think that's a good deal. They don't pay too much to get him either. Delorier, some people have their eyebrows raised about him. I don't have my eyebrows raised as much about the deal, the 4-year, $1.75 million, because I think he is a pretty... He's a tough guy. He's an enforcer. He's one of the few enforcers left in hockey. He might not put up the points, but he'll hit guys. He'll get the team involved. He'll get the guys going when they're down. So you got to have that on the team, I think. They bring back Justin Braun, Morgan Frost, Owen Tippett. But yeah, the overall, not much going on. I don't even know that Philadelphia knows what they are, because just the moves they make is like they're building, but they're just not a great team. So we'll see. Maybe I'll be surprised. The pattern ended, though, so it's not like I'm going to pick them to make the playoffs this year, because... the pattern ended. That's the only reason anybody picked them to make the playoffs last year, and it disappointed. So, but now moving on to the Pittsburgh Penguins. And Pittsburgh's another team I just gave a C+, mainly because they didn't really get better. They just managed to keep everybody. And added a pretty decent cap hit. So if you want to raise it a little bit, the grade, I could understand that. But they do get Ty Smith for a 2023 third, and they get rid of John Marino. Obviously, I said earlier, John Marino, a very solid defenseman. But like I said, Ty Smith, at this point, I'm just saying, like I said, because all the trades I've gone through, because we're at the bottom of the alphabet. But Ty Smith, he is a guy who's looking to bounce back from last season, and I think he can, and Pittsburgh could be the right place to do that. It's definitely a risky move, though, on their end, especially for a team that's trying to make the playoffs for as long as they can, because they're also kind of in that position. They sign all these guys, Chris Letang, to a 6-year deal. It's a little high. $6 million, though, not too bad of a cap hit. And they signed Evgeny Malkin to a 4-year deal. Again, exact same cap hit, and I think that's pretty good. The problem with Malkin is he gets hurt all the time. But yeah, mostly they just keep the same team together, and not a bad offseason for Pittsburgh. And I'm going to have to pause this. I'm getting a phone call, so I'll be back. Okay, sorry about that. We're good. Not even going to check the mic quality, because if it sucks, then too bad for you guys. It already sucks already, so how could it get any worse? But where was I? I think I just finished Pittsburgh. So now onto the San Jose Sharks. And San Jose, I have given them a D+, which might be a little low for some of you. Some of you might think that they deserve a higher grade. But honestly, I just don't think Greer is at his first time. I don't think his first offseason was that great. And I think it all started at the draft when he decided to trade that 11th overall pick for a ton of depth picks. And I feel like that 11th overall pick, they could have got so many people like Frank Nizar, as I said earlier. So I think they had an opportunity to get some very good players, and they kind of passed on that to go for some other players who could end up being some solid forwards, some solid players someday. But again, I feel like they need that blue chip prospect, and they kind of passed that opportunity. Acquired Luke Kunin, though, which I liked, and they gave up Brent Burns, which I feel like they could have got more for Brent Burns. Like, I get he's 37, his contract is expensive, but they retained the salary, and I just feel like they probably could have done a bit better in that trade as well. And then they brought in some depth players, Nico Sturm, 3 years at $2 million. Honestly, not a bad deal. It could age poorly just because this season was not a great one for him, especially in Colorado. It was a rough one. Just not very good in Colorado or in the playoffs. He had a rough playoffs as well. They bring in Matt Benning, some good depth on the defense. They bring in Kaapo Kähkönen. Well, they didn't bring him in. They re-sign him to a contract that I think is pretty solid. But the one thing that gets me with San Jose is it feels like every year there are not great teams that thinks they're going to be good. And this year, I believe Greer said the same thing. Like, he said, we're a good team. I think we're going to make the playoffs. I'm pretty sure. I might be wrong. But if he said that, it's like, how do you have two GMs in a row that think that this team is a good team? Because it's not. Every year, they think it's good, and it's not. It's not. The players are just getting too old. Marlowe, gone a while ago. Joe Thornton, who was there in the prime days, gone. Brent Burns now is really old, and he's gone. And then you got all these other guys, whatever. Everybody's just getting older on that team. That core's getting older, and they're clearly not good enough to keep winning. So I don't know why they keep pushing for it. They should just accept the fact that they need to rebuild. They need to get good prospects, and they're just not doing that, and they continue to deny. So I gave them a D+. But now moving on to the Seattle Kraken. Spit a little bit there. And the Seattle Kraken, I give them the second best grade of any team in this video. I gave them AA. I just think the Seattle Kraken had a rough expansion draft, right? After the expansion draft, I walked away thinking, what are they doing? I didn't understand. Although I did like the Grubauer contract at the time, I liked the goaltending. That's clearly not aged well. But as a team as the whole, I was like, okay, why? You could have got Domi, you could have got Tarasenko. Things could have been so much better. But then I look back and I look at what they've done this season, and I kind of understand it a bit more. Like, they got Bjorkstrand for free with all that cap space that they saved in the expansion draft. So they got Bjorkstrand for free. They signed Andrei Burakovsky to a pretty good 5-year, $5.5 million deal. And he's only 27, so this deal should look pretty good throughout. Shane Wright, they obviously fell into their lap, and he's on the ELC, so it'll be interesting to see what he can do this season. Martin Jones, some depth in net, which they need. They need, definitely. Driedger and Grubauer disappointed a little bit last season, and when they disappointed, well, there was nobody else to do anything, really. So Martin Jones could, I guess, potentially be a decent backup is really what it is, but it's some depth, I guess, in net if Grubauer fails again. And I think Driedger's hurt for the first bit of the season as well. But yeah, overall, I just like the additions that they made, and I think they've taken a good step forward into playoff contention next year. Again, weak Pacific Division, so they could definitely surprise. But now moving on to the St. Louis Blues. And the St. Louis Blues, I gave them a C-. So they traded Ville Husso, they got a third. They probably couldn't do too much. Ville Husso was a RFA anyway, so whatever, that happens. They still have whatever their goalie is. What's their goalie? Jordan Binnington, and he's a pretty solid goalie normally, at least in the playoffs. He's still trying to find that game a bit in the regular season, it feels like. But really, they re-signed Robert Thomas to a long-term deal. Nick Leddy, I thought they overpaid for a bit, 4 years, $4 million, especially at his age in the season he had last year. Defensively was not very good, so I don't love that signing very much. And Thomas Greiss they bring in to replace Husso as that backup position, which is kind of risky. He did not have a great year in Detroit, so they're definitely hoping that he can bounce back in St. Louis. I mean, I'd hope they're hoping. If they're hoping he doesn't bounce back, then we got some other problems, I'm not gonna lie. But honestly, St. Louis, it feels like they've kind of gotten a little worse and taken a little bit of a step back this season. But now moving on to the Tampa Bay Lightning. And Tampa Bay annoyed me so much this offseason. They just did. And I'm going to give them a D+. So we start off, right? I'm going to do the signings first this time instead of the trade. They sign Nick Paul, 7 years, 3.15. Not bad. I don't hate that deal. But now let's get to all the ones that they paid a ton of money for. A ton. They signed Mikhail Sergachev to 8 years at $8.5 million. Sergachev is a great defenseman, don't get me wrong, but I just don't think he's worth $8.5 million. I feel like he's very good defensively, very good, and he puts up some decent offensive numbers, not amazing, but some decent ones. And this year, not being as great as here offensively either, I do think $8.5 million is a lot for Mikhail Sergachev, but we'll see. And then not only that though, they go to Anthony Cirelli. And Cirelli gets 8 years at $6.25 million. That's a lot of money for Cirelli, I think. I feel like he would have been better around that $5 million range, but he goes up to $6.25. It's a high price for Anthony Cirelli. And then we go on to Eric Cernak, 8 years, $5.2 million. This one I don't hate as much, but you're still giving all these guys a ton of money for 8 years. Like, long-term, lots of money deals. And I think this is going to come back to bite them 100%. And that, in part, all this money being spent in part leads to them having to trade away Ryan McDonagh, and which they don't get a lot back for, because obviously they're kind of trying to dump some cap space off because they've just re-signed all these guys for a ton of money. They also bring Vladislav Nemestikov, don't hate that move. Ian Cole, they bring in on a 1-year deal for $3 million, don't hate that move. But I gave him a D plus purely because just the amount of money they spent on these guys, I feel like each one was overpaid just a little bit, just a little bit, just a little bit. And when you overpay these guys on these huge term deals just a little bit, it all counts up, it all accumulates, and now you've got like $4 million more than maybe you would have wanted to spend for the next 8 years. And it's just, they put a lot of money into this team, and I'm starting to question whether this team is going to be a cup contender again, which I probably shouldn't, because they've made the final year after year after year. Even this year they made the final, they lost, but I don't know, they just keep losing pieces every year, and that's how it is as a cup contender. But yeah, their GM did not have the greatest offseason, in my opinion. But now moving on to Toronto. And Toronto was a team that took a good amount of risks this offseason, specifically in net. And overall, I've given them a C, just an okay offseason. But in net, they trade for Matt Murray. They get a couple stuff that's partly retained. This could either be a great move or a bad move. The problem is Matt Murray's had like two down seasons in a row, maybe even three. I don't even remember. It's been a rough time for Murray over the last few years, and he's been injured as well throughout the time. So this is definitely a risky move because he's still on their cap hit as $4.4 million. So if he sucks, that's a lot of money going to a goalie who's not playing very well. But the other goalie move they made that I did like was signing Ilya Samsonov as that supposedly backup, although I could see him taking that step forward and being the starter. Only $1.8 million, like I said. And Samsonov, he had a bit of a down year in Washington. Again, like, they picked two goalies who've had a down years, and one of them is bound to bounce back, right? I feel like that's what Dubas is going in here thinking. He's like, one of these goalies is going to bounce back. Maybe not both of them, but one of them has to. Personally, I'd bet on Samsonov more than Murray, because Samsonov's younger. He's shown that he can be really good, especially a few years ago. And this year was kind of just a rough year, but I do like the moves overall. It's definitely a risk. We'll see if it works out for them. Other than that, they kind of make some depth moves. They signed Cal Yarenkrok to a pretty good deal. And overall, it just leads to it being an okay offseason. Kind of, we'll see how it goes. And again, especially in net, we'll see how it goes. I'm intrigued to watch this team next year, purely because I just want to see whether Matt Murray and Ilya Samsonov can hold up and get this team past that bump, get this team past the first round. Because I don't think we have a doubt that they're going to make the playoffs. It's whether they can actually get far in the playoffs. And every year, I feel like it's going to happen, and it doesn't. And I feel like it's going to happen this year, which means it's not, because that's just how it is for Toronto fans. But, and then the media is going to talk about it, and all I'm going to be hearing about is Toronto and the media, and I'm going to love it. Thank God. Thank God Edmonton media talks about Toronto all the time. It's absolutely fantastic. Moving on to the Vancouver Canucks. Four teams left in this video. Thank God, getting to the end of it. It's been a long video. I'm at like 45 minutes in recording time. I don't know how I'm going to post all this. I do all this stuff on my phone, so this is going to be a struggle. And I don't even think the quality is that good. I watched back the first half of the phone call like a little bit, and the quality of the sound was not very good. And the quality of the video was not very good because I don't have the right lighting, because we'll just say there's some stuff going on and I don't have the lighting right now. So it makes the camera quality seem a lot worse than I would want it to. But Vancouver, I gave them a C. And Brock Besser, they re-signed. They get Curtis Lazar. I like those moves. And they get Ilya Mikheyev for a bit of an expensive contract. 4 years, 4.75. He is 27. This deal could work out. But their GM, I think it's Alvin, is their GM. He clearly sees Mikheyev as a top six forward. You don't give a guy $4.75 million in the NHL if you expect him to be on your bottom two lines, but we'll see how that works out. Just an okay offseason, pretty dead for them. But now moving on to Vegas, and Vegas is the only team that I had to give an F. I just had to. They pissed me off so much. Like I said, Tampa made me mad. Vegas made me more mad, and that's hard to do because I don't like Tampa very much. So A, Vegas trades Dadonov for Weber. Weber's hurt. It's basically nothing. They trade Dadonov for nothing, we'll say. And Dadonov was a solid player, but teams take advantage of this because they're like, all right, Vegas' GM is an idiot and doesn't know what he's doing, so he's just going to keep signing all these big contracts, and he's going to need to get rid of them because cap space exists, or the cap exists, and I don't think the Vegas GM still understands that, because we're probably going to see him sign Kadri right away, guaranteed. Just wouldn't be surprised one bit. But Dadonov traded for free, and then we see Pacioretty also got traded for free this offseason. So that's two trades that they made this offseason. Both of them were just giving up players. So they gave up Evgeny Dadonov, Max Pacioretty, and they received nothing. And the Max Pacioretty one shocked me even more because it's Max Pacioretty. It's not like he's a bad player. It's just Vegas has no cap space and they have to trade someone out. So yeah, it's just like, it's embarrassing. And then Riley Smith, they signed to a 3-year, $5 million deal, which is kind of ironic because they clear up all this cap space. And then they signed Riley Smith to this deal. Vegas. Now moving on to the Washington Capitals. In the Washington Capitals, I have given them just a C minus. They traded away Vitek Vanacek. They only got like basically a third and they moved up in the second round. You're not going to get a ton for Vitek Vanacek. They get Connor Brown for a second, which I like. And then they sign Darcy Kemper to an expensive contract. 5 years, $5.25 million. And the problem with this is I really don't expect that to age well. He was kind of falling off in Arizona a bit. And then he went to Colorado, and Colorado is a great team. Every goalie has shown, Colorado has shown that any goalie that goes there will put up good numbers. That shows with Philip Grubauer, that showed with Darcy Kemper, and I'm sure that will show with Alexander Georgiev. That's why that deal that looks a little high, I think it's going to work out because he's bound to put up some good numbers there no matter what, just because of the shot quality, how good Colorado is, all that. But then they bring in Dylan Strome to a one-year deal, which I like. And overall, I just see this as a miss offseason, not the greatest, because it's like Nicholas Backstrom is having surgery and they're trying to like replace that. They're trying to make sure that they stay in contention. And Darcy Kemper being in net might help with that. But again, they paid a huge price in 5 years, considering he's 32, is a lot. And are Connor Brown and Dylan Strome enough to replace that offensive firepower that Nicholas Backstrom brought to the table? I don't know. Only time will tell. And then on to the last team that we have in this video, and the one that made the least moves out of any team, or at least the least big enough moves that actually make an impact on a player, and that is Winnipeg. And Winnipeg, I gave them a D, just a straight D, not an F, just a D. It's like, your team last year didn't do good, so you clearly have to switch something up. You have to make a trade, you have to switch the locker room up. New coach, they tried that. Also, the coach they brought in, I don't even like. Who did they bring in? They brought in Dallas's old coach. I did not like that move either. So really, just not a great offseason. The only thing they did was they re-signed Pierre-Luc Dubois. And he wants out anyway, basically, as far as what his agent said. Of course, he's going to deny it. But his agents basically said that he wants out. So Winnipeg didn't change up anything. I don't like what they did. And the fact that they didn't make the playoffs last year, I skipped the Islanders. All right, so now moving on to the New York Islanders. And the New York Islanders, I also gave a D because same reason. Exactly. Winnipeg and Islanders, I'll just double tag them right here. Both of them missed the playoffs. Both their GMs think that they're good enough to make it. And for both teams, I just don't see it. More so with the Islanders. And yeah, so thank you guys for watching. This video has been a pain for me. It's been as much of a pain for me to make as a pain for you to watch if you're still here. So thank you for watching, really, if you're still here. You're a trooper, because I feel amazing and like a trooper right now for just standing here for 45 minutes. This is crazy. So again, thanks for watching. I'm going to try to cut this video down as much as I can. I really don't think I'm going to be able to do it that much. I think it's going to be like 45 minutes long, but kind of expected it. I'm hoping my phone can take this, because I don't think it will be able to, just storage wise. But yeah, again, thank you guys for watching. I hope you enjoyed. And hopefully, I will see you in the next video, which hopefully won't be 45 minutes long. So, yeah, see you guys.